CMSC 355, what's up? I hope y'all are doing great. I'm gonna give you until the end of the song, please clone and build and run that repository that I've just put in the chat. Clone and build and run that repository I've just put in the chat. And if you like the song, don't forget to hit the heart and Minty. Thank you. For those of you that are just joining, please clone and build and run the repository that I've linked in the chat. We're going to be starting in just a minute. Until then, enjoy the song. again, for those of you just joining, please go ahead and clone and build and run that repository, which I've just put a link to in the chat. Clone and build and run. Thanks. Hope you all have had a chance to clone and build and run that repository. If not, continue to do so as we get started with the class. We're going to be using that a little bit later on. Let me stop that song. All right. So hopefully you've had a chance to do that. Again, it might require you to install some plugins and things like that. Usually you can just click on the error message and things will automatically get installed. Let me know if you have too many problems. We'll try and get you sorted out, but it should be relatively straightforward to get it up and running. Okay, today we're going to be talking about debugging. And this is something that I've noticed when I've worked with y'all. This must not be like something they've taught a lot in the curriculum, because some of the strategies y'all use are, you know, they're not bad. They're just some tricks that you should know that you don't know yet. We're going to go over some of those today. Now, first, a few things in the way of announcements. There was an assignment due last Friday. That was a demo video of your project. Hopefully everybody has turned those in. I've seen 20 of those, which is a little bit less than normal. So that's a little worrisome. Hopefully y'all get those in if you haven't. The next assignment is due next Tuesday. Okay, it is already released on Gradescope. The next assignment is due next Tuesday. Now, you may ask, let's do next week. So what could it be? It can't be something that's too big because we only have about a week and a day to do it. All it is you're going to do essentially the same thing that you did last time. You're going to create a demo video, but you're going to show the difference between what you were able to do by last Friday and what you're able to do by next Tuesday. Okay, so you're going to create a new demo video, 1 minute or less, and show off any new features that you've been able to make. Okay, you don't need to go over the old ones. Just show off any new features that you were able to make. So that's what's going to be due next Tuesday. Again, it's already up on Gradescope. You're going to be turning in both your old video and your new video so I can watch them side by side and see kind of the new things and how things have changed. So I will notice, even if, you know, maybe you don't have a lot of new features, but you have a new look to it, I'll definitely notice that because I'll be watching the old and the new video. So just keep that in mind. After that, there will be one final group and individual assignment that is due by the end of the semester. And that'll be due in December, you know, towards the end of the semester. I'll try and give you guys and gals as much time as possible, but I'll let you know more about that next week. And second midterm will be, of course, after Thanksgiving and all that, when y'all, or at least, you know, you're allowed to be at home or wherever you're going to be, so it'll be remote again, kind of like the first one. Somebody's asking for the assignment next Tuesday, do bug fixes work? Yes, absolutely. If you had a bug, you can, of course, fix it and then show me how it's fixed. That's great. Just make sure you kind of explain what the bug was before, or you could even show the bug before and then after you fix it. And just wanted to reiterate, so with assignment due on Tuesday, one final group and individual assignment one more midterm, and that is it. Okay? Y'all are nearing the end of the semester. Been pushing hard, especially some of y'all have been doing steady commits here. That has been great. So we don't have that much more to do, other than, you know, that last deliverable for our group assignment and one more before that. Okay, so we're getting there. Yes, and the second midterm is going, you know, during the final day. Absolutely. So last time we talked about code reviews. And the code reviews is just going over your code with somebody else so you can find things that maybe you wouldn't find on your own. It's a great way to improve your code quality, but it's also a great way to learn how to code from other developers. Today we're going to be talking about debugging. Okay, we're just going to talk general concepts and ideas on debugging. We might talk more about debugging later, but we're going to kind of start it off right here. This is something that practically I think y'all need a little bit to pay a little bit more attention to. So, one of the things that is really important in debugging is the idea of live debugging, okay? And this is just the idea that while your code is running, you can, in fact, look into the variables and the state of your running program using things like the debugger. And this is something that I don't see a lot of people doing. Kind of at the heart of this concept, or the origination of this concept, is something called the REPL read eval print loop. And I want to just show you what the REPL is here in this very brief video. First of all, so you know what it is. But second of all, because it's just kind of something that is a good way to think about like the concept of debugging. If you're able to see and inspect and change the system live and see it very quickly, you're actually able to debug a lot faster. So using the debugger and using it in almost like a REPL fashion will help you become a better developer because you'll figure out things faster. Anyway, just to introduce what the REPL is, let's take a look at this brief video. Here's what a REPL is.
Now in this video, let us now check out what is REPL. That is R-E-P-L, read, eval, print loop. So here at the top, you will find tools, inside which you will have Kotlin, within which you will find Kotlin REPL. So simply select it. And this will simply open a window at the bottom. Now the purpose of using REPL is that inside the REPL, you can run your Kotlin code as quickly as possible. Let's say, let us type 1 plus 2 and let's see what happens. Now to execute the code inside the REPL, you need to simply press Command plus Enter in case of Mac, and in case of Windows, you have to type Control plus Enter. So since I'm using Mac, so I will simply use Command plus Enter. And now here I get 3 as the output. So inside the REPL, you can simply execute your codes as quickly as possible. Let's try something different. 10 minus, let's say 7, Command plus Enter, we get 3. Right, now let's try something different. 10 divided by 7, Control plus Enter, we get 1 as the output since we are using 10 and 7 as integer value. Now let us use 10.0 divided by 7, Control plus Enter, and here we get the decimal point value, that is the exact value that we will get by dividing 10.0 divided by 7, right? The floating point value we are getting here. Now let us try something different, print, and then let us type hello, and now Control plus Enter, and here we get hello in the output console, right? So the purpose of using REPL is that you can test your code as quickly as possible. So whatever code that we will write inside the main function, if you want to test it without running the whole application, you can simply copy and paste it here and simply press Control plus Enter in the REPL, right? So as to test your output. And now here you can simply type var space str equal to, let's say, hello, hit enter. Now remember, I have simply pressed enter, not Control plus Enter. So in the next line, I can simply perform some operation on this str variable, let's say str plus, and now hit enter. And now I will simply print the value of str. So in this way, you can simply type multiple lines in case of REPL. And now simply press Ctrl plus enter. And here we get the output as hello world combined, right? So in this way, you can simply type multiple lines in case of REPL as well. So this was all about this video. And at last, I would say REPL stands for read, eval, print, loop. So always remember this. So see you guys.
All right, so that's what a REPL is. Does that remind you guys and gals of anything that is in Android Studio? Does that remind you of anything that is in Android Studio? What is that similar to in terms of tooling in Android Studio? Let me know what you think in the chat. What does that remind you of in Android Studio? Or what is it most similar to, okay? What is it most similar to inside of Android Studio? Take some guesses. Oh, hello, hello. Are you out there, people? Wake up, wake up. Gonna play more Bryan Adams if you don't wake up. Might play more Bryan Adams anyway. People are blanking. Anybody got a guess? Any tooling in Android Studio that reminds you of what a REPL terminal? That's probably a good guess. Console, yep. So, yeah, so I'm not as familiar as like in Eclipse, for instance, where I am an expert, there is something like this. I think in Android Studio, there probably is something similar. But if you take a step back and you think about kind of the purpose of this, where you can inspect values, in the debug console, it's very similar to the debug console. That's a great answer. That's what I'm looking for is your debug console. I think there is probably a debug window where you can actually execute things like that. Like you can type code and have it execute. But there's also, of course, where you can just look at the variables and look at their values, okay? So it's very important when you're debugging to understand how to debug, how to hit breakpoints, how to look at values, things like that. Anyway, this is just a little bit of introduction to the tooling that can allow you to become a better debugger. But let's take a step back and just talk about the first bug. Where did it come from? Why are they called bugs? Well, back in the day, there was literally a bug in the machine on relay number 70, panel F. There was a moth, and that caused the program to fail. And that was documented here, and that was actually like the first case of a bug being found. That's why it's called a bug. William brings up a great point. So the debug console, it has a live coding function. And it allows you to run code when you're paused at a breakpoint. And this is exactly, or almost exactly the same thing as what we just saw. You can also, of course, just look at all the values of the variables in the program. Okay. So those are important tools you need to be aware of. So the term bug is used somewhat informally because it's not a very precise term. Okay. Sometimes people mean faults, sometimes they mean errors, sometimes they mean failures. And so, you know, it's not a very precise term, and we're going to introduce some other terms here that kind of refine that. But, you know, you can see the use of these different terms here. And we'll talk more about like different terms we can use in the future. One of the things about debugging is that it's a real skill that you need to learn as a developer, and you really need to rely on your tools like we've just talked about, and you need to almost become as a detective, right? There's always going to be bugs in your program, no matter how good you are as a developer. There's just always going to be bugs in programs, and you'll need to find them. And you basically become a detective, find them, and you use the tools that are available to find these bugs. Now, as I mentioned, we're going to talk a little bit more precisely about bugs. For instance, these bugs come in three stages. There is a fault, which is where the bug originates from. It's like the code that actually causes things to go wrong. This fault causes an infection or an error, and the error becomes externally visible to the user, or yeah, to the user basically. That's called a failure. Okay. Not every defect is visible, right? And not every like kind of error or infection is visible. So it's important to kind of differentiate between these different terms. There's not going to be any real quiz on the, I'm not going to hit these terms real hard on quizzes or anything, but I think it's just important to know like there's code where things go wrong, and then there's the actual place where you see the output of things going wrong, and those are not always the same place, right? Like you could have set a variable to null way in the past, and that doesn't fail for hundreds of lines of code, and that's where you find the thing that went wrong, but that is different than where the actual code made it go wrong. So for instance, here is an example, the difference between faults and errors and failures. So here we have a fault. We have I equal to 1 instead of I equal to 0. You know, it should start at 1. The error is that I is equal to 1, not 0. But there is no failure in this particular case because our test, let's say, still passes, okay? However, if we had another test case, we would still have this fault in the same place, and we would still have this error where I is equal to 1, but we would get the wrong value back. We would actually see a problem. So in the first case, we actually don't see a problem because our test passes. In the second case, we do see a problem because our test kind of fails. So this is all to say that, like, you know, there is where the code is wrong, and then there is where the problem occurs, which is kind of where this returns to. And sometimes, we like with this test case, we actually see the problem because it manifests itself in a failing test. I'm sorry, right here, this test fails. And sometimes we don't see a problem. This test actually passes. So fault, error, and then failure, where we see the problem, not a failure, where we don't see the problem. Thing about debugging is that it is really a searching problem. You're going to have to, like, look, you're looking for the failure state of the program. You're not only looking like across all of your code, but you're looking across time. Like sometimes it would, you know, fail only during startup, or sometimes it would only fail after it's been running for days. And so, you know, it can be really tricky. You're searching on like multiple dimensions. Now, the debugging process has, you know, some very clear steps that you can do to kind of proceed in it. First, you can, you know, if it's a formal bug, you can track the problem in a bug database, reproduce the failure. That's a big part of debugging. You can create, automate, and simplify a test case. And then you can start looking for the origins, focus on the most likely origins, isolate the infection, and correct the defect. These are the basic steps. And one of the things that gives a lot of people problems or is really tricky is reproducing the failure. Okay, and we're going to look at that right here. So for those of you that have downloaded that app, please try to reproduce this issue right here. Issue 751. I will show you the issue as well, but this issue, I'm going to put it in the chat. You're going to try and reproduce this issue in your own version of the code, okay? Reproduce this issue in your own version of the code. I'll open this issue up so you can see it. This issue is, there are no tooltips on the subreddit toolbar on the Reddit browser app that we have downloaded. I want you to let me know in the chat when somebody has been able to reproduce this. Everybody try and reproduce this. And please let me know when you are able to reproduce this in the chat. If you have issues getting it to run, that is something else that you could definitely work on fixing. I was able to get it to run. That is a big part of getting started with software development, is getting things to run is not easy. So you can try and work on that. I'm going to give you guys and gals just a few minutes. We really want to try and get this running and working. And I'm going to, if you're having trouble getting it to run, please, you know, describe in the chat the problems that you're having. Those of you that can get it to run, please try and reproduce this problem. Some people are still running their Gradle sync. I don't know about that. Yep, so somebody's saying I get something about distribution SHA. I believe they're... Yeah. I think you can do what Reckless Garage said. And while we're, let's see, share my screen. All right. So you can see that I've got mine working right here. And I've got the app building right here. Just so you know, it can be done. So some of you might have noticed that you have been able to build successfully, but you don't have the option to run. So if you don't have the option to run, I think you're going to need to make sure you have a configuration selected. Looks like maybe you could also just build again. So some people are having trouble understanding the bug, please continue to try and reproduce the bug just for a minute or two. That is something that we are definitely going to go over. But please just try and understand as best you can and find it. And by a show of hands, in terms of people that can get it built, just say a yes in the chat if you can get this built. Can get this building, say yes in the chat. If you... Some people are getting it to run, that's great. Good. All right, and for those of you that are building it, getting it built and running, that first of all, great, but continue to try and decipher what what it is that bug me. You have a touch screen. Yeah, that's interesting. Okay, I'm gonna give you guys and gals one more minute to try and reproduce this bug, and then we're gonna see if we can reproduce it together. All right, so let's just try and look at this together now. I'm going to try and share my full screen. And here we go. Hopefully you can see my app, right? All right, so let's look at that bug. I'm going to pull it up. You guys can be looking at it too, but well, I'll just put right here, no tooltips in new subreddit toolbar. All right, so you should see my screen. You should see no tooltips in new subreddit toolbar. And when long selecting a button on the new subreddit toolbar, no tooltip, toast, or similar appears to describe what the button does. Okay, so as suggested by, I can't remember who that was because I don't have my chat up. You can see that the way that we would usually have a tooltip is we would long click on something. Basically, or if it was our actual finger, we would just hold down on it and eventually something would come up. Let me see if you guys and gals are chatting. Yep. So can anybody... Now I'm looking at the chat. Can anybody tell me where you think I should go to reproduce this bug? Who can tell me exactly what to click? At least for the first thing to click. What do you think I should click next to try and find where this bug is? Anybody got a guess? Where should I click to find where this bug is? Anybody got a guess? What should I click on? You know, in the chats. We'll be Brian Adams music soon. And while we wait. Come on, guys and gals. There we go. On a toolbar, the top one. All right, cool. So, I don't know. I'll click on this. What do you guys and gals think I should click on next? Somebody's telling me this isn't the subreddit toolbar, so you have to exit that screen. Okay, so I'm going to go with that. So one of the things that you will need to know as a developer, is this is not actually the subreddit screen. So you need to exit this screen. Thanks, Colden. That is exactly right. This is just the front page of Reddit, apparently. And so I'm going to go ahead and exit this screen. Now I am here. Who can tell me where I would want to go to, what I would want to click on next to try and find this bug? So now, where would I go next to try and reproduce this bug? All right, and so clicking anything under these subscribe subreddits, I think this is a good one. Let's go for this. Let's go for books. That sounds like a good thing. And you can see lots of things now. Now, what should I do to try and reproduce this bug on this page? Who can tell me what to do next? Click and hold the share button. All right, so for those of you that don't know, I mean, I think you probably know, this is probably the share button. I'm going to try and reproduce this bug. I'm going to pull that bug right back up so we can see it again. When long selecting a button This is the subreddit toolbar, new subreddit toolbar. I'm gonna long click on this. And you can see that nothing happens. I've been long clicking on it for a while now. I'll let go. Nothing happens. Other than, of course, the share. I wonder if something happens here. Aha! So, check it out. A long click here, nothing happens. But a long click here, refresh post. You can see a tooltip there. So that's what they're talking about. Long click here, nothing happens. Long click up here, refresh post. All right, so you can see from just this information, this is a super trivial bug report, by the way, how difficult it can be to reproduce a bug. And that is, in fact, a lesson that we were trying to drive home. Reproducing bugs is a big part of the battle in debugging things. Like, reproducing them is one of the hardest parts of debugging. Now, let me go back to OBS so I can go back to the sharing. All right, so that was just a quick lesson in how difficult it can be to reproduce bugs. We're going to go ahead and move on to some more content. Now, whenever you have a bug, whether it's reported by a user or by you or however it gets reported, you need to kind of track these things. Because what happens is there's going to be a whole bunch of them in your project, regardless of the project. And you're going to want to be able to track, like keep a to-do list of what you want to work on. That's why we have in GitHub, we have issues, we have things like Bugzilla or Pivotal Track or GitHub's issues. And it's basically a database where we store these. You do it so that you don't have duplicate bugs on your list. You can provide context for the bug. You can prioritize which ones we want to work on next. And you can even relate them to your code or your releases or things like that. So it's very important to track these bugs so you can just organize your work, just like you would any type of work. Now, as we just saw in that example, again, that was a super trivial bug, which should be the easiest type to reproduce. It didn't depend on any kind of dynamic context. It was really just like, there's no tooltip here. And you could see it's really hard to understand what the person meant. And then, of course, once we figured out kind of what they meant, still the fact that long select was how to trigger the bug is not obvious. So the tricks about reproducing problems is you have to recreate the environment, like you have to figure out how exactly they were set up. And then you have to do the steps that they did in order to trigger the bug. The most important thing I would say is your environment. You have to be running on the same version of the software, at least. And often you might even have to run on the same hardware to reproduce it. And so you start there and, you know, keep on going until your environments and setup are identical. The problem is that there are, you know, when you're on phones already, there's hundreds and hundreds of different types of phones. When you think about even computers, there's, you know, thousands, if not million plus different computer configurations. And so if you're trying to reproduce their environment and they don't tell you their exact environment, it can be super difficult because there's just so many different types of environments. So that's a real challenge. After you go ahead and find like some setup like that's similar to theirs, at least, like let's say you're on a Pixel, the user that reported it is on a Pixel 4, or maybe I have a Pixel 3, and that's like somewhat close to their environment. You still have to figure out how to trigger the execution path, which they went down, meaning press the same buttons or do the same things in order to cause the same problem. You'll have to do things like get all the data you need without getting too much data. Like, I don't want to get your password. But I do want to get, you know, oh, well, you had problems with like this type of item or that type of data. But again, I don't want to get your actual data. So there's a lot of privacy issues here. So yeah, I want to kind of get the input that the user went through without violating any privacy issues. And an interesting Well, kind of a typical first thought is, well, yeah, you want to just record what the user is doing and then replay it back. But getting a user to do that for you is really unlikely, right? Like, there's a lot of overhead in doing that. Doing things like tracing can cost a lot of like resources on your computer or your phone. It may not even run. And so, like, getting the user or asking somebody to do some kind of special tracing on their own device, while you might have to do it in some very rare cases, this is not going to be a good typical solution because it's just not worth it for the user, right? Like, their bug usually isn't that bad. They don't want to go through all these crazy diagnostics with you. They just want to, submit their bug and move on. Another thing that's going to be really tricky is there's a lot of randomness and concurrency issues that you're going to run into. Like, for instance, if you have a program that is based on a random number generator, reproducing a bug that runs and then generates a random number, you might have that eventually causes a crash. You may have to run that program like 100 times before you can reproduce that crash. And the same thing for like time of day bugs and things like that. And even worse, if you have some kind of concurrency issue where there's several threads working together and the threads have to be in all in different states to trigger this one bug, you might have to run your test thousands or millions of times in order to recreate just that exact execution state that caused your bug. So anything to do with randomness and concurrency is going to be a lot harder to debug. Another potential issue that you're going to run into is something called a Heisen bug. And this is just a bug that actually kind of changes if you try and observe it. And this is really just a caveat for debugging, okay? So this code fails outside of the debugger only. Like, when you debug it, it works. And it fails if you run it in a normal execution mode. And that's because the debugger does actually have some effect on the code. It doesn't usually cause any practical problems, but in this particular case, it does cause the code to behave differently, whether it's in the debugger or not, because of the timing of things. And this is just to know that when you are running in the debugger, it changes the timing of threads, it changes the behavior program in certain ways. And so you may not be able to observe all of the problems in your program when you're debugging because it does, in fact, change the behavior. It slows down the program. A Heisen bug, again, is just a bug that changes when you try and observe it. Like, in this case, it passes in the debugger and it fails when you run it normally. So, when you want to start looking into a bug, the first thing you want to do is make it reproducible. And you want to do that like manually, okay? So, in the case that we just saw, we wanted to, go ahead and make the tooltip show up. We wanted to do that manually. Once you can do it manually, you might want to automate it. Now, in the case of a tooltip, I don't know if I would actually automate that, but if it was a sequence of steps that was leading to a failure, yeah, I would actually want to automate that so that I can know, right now this test is failing. And in the future, when I write the code that makes it work, then the test is passing. So it's always a good idea to automate the execution of this path that causes failure and so that you can make sure that it's actually fixed. So, just to summarize what we talked about today, debugging, that is a very important skill. And it's a really a skill that you learn through using the debugging tool, becoming kind of a detective, and understanding what tools are really available to you. Once you have a problem tracked in an issue tracker, A big problem is that you have to reproduce it on your own setup. Okay, so it's one thing for the user to have a bug, and you know that that's a bug. The users usually aren't lying; something really went wrong. But it's an entirely different thing for you to be able to reproduce it on your own machine. Just like in the way we say, "Hey, this code works for me; it's good to go," and of course it isn't. It fails on other people's machines. If code fails on their machine, you need to figure out how to set up your machine to also fail in the same way. Reproducing the problem is a big challenge. You have to set up your environment in the same way, reproduce exactly what they did, and remember, logging is your friend when you're dealing with debugging. All right, with that, I'd like to go ahead and open it up to questions. I'm sure y'all have some questions on things like assignments. Oops, forgot to make a question slide. Hold on, let me make that real quick. That's a nice way to get questions. All right. If y'all have any questions, please hit me up now. And otherwise, that's going to be the end of class for today. We're going to be back here on Tuesday, lectures as normal for the rest of the semester, which is basically this week and next week. And then we will be getting into final exam and the final project deliverable. So somebody's asking, can we get extra credit if we close the bug request? For this particular example, nah, it's not really a hard enough bug. Sorry. I'm glad that y'all could probably close this bug request. That's great. But it's just not an interesting enough bug to warrant that. Nice try, though. Will points be taken? Here's the next question. Will points be taken off if the demo video is over a minute? Ooh, well, it's hard to say. Depends on how much over a minute it is. But just know, when I ask for a video that's a minute long, every second over the minute limit that I have to watch will make me angrier. And you don't want me to be too angry when I'm grading. Now, obviously I'm not going to be like a jerk about it or anything. I'm not interested in giving you guys and gals bad grades at all. But just know, if you're at work and your boss asks you for a minute demo, he's not going to fire you if it's like a minute and 10 seconds. But, you know, if it's a minute, 45 seconds, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, he's going to start to get irritated when you're showing it to a client or something, because he's like, hey, I asked for a minute and you made me a 3 minute video. Like, that's not what I asked for. So with these deliverables, they're guidelines and they're there. Help you help yourselves. Hopefully that answers your question. Any other questions that y'all have, hit me up. We will be back here on Wednesday with the next lecture, also on debugging. Here's an interesting question. What if we're mostly done or done with the app and there are not a lot of improvements, bugs to make fix? This is referring to the assignment due next Tuesday. First of all, you know, I want to say this without being rude, but I really doubt that you have an app that does not have a lot of improvements or bugs that are available for making. I just don't believe the first statement here. But here's, in all seriousness, here's what I would do if I were you. You could make a meeting with me, and I could look at your app and say, hey, here's what I would improve about it. I'm happy to do that. Not a problem. I would ask your friends, hey, look at this. Like, you know, what's wrong with it? Or what could I improve about it? There is pretty much no app that is done, right? Like, they're all in different stages of being perfected. And your app is not going to be, you know, an exception to this rule. Somebody's asking, when is the app due again? So I only make deliverables one kind of one deliverable out so that you don't get overwhelmed. So it's going to be due kind of near the final, the midterm or whatever, the second midterm. I haven't decided on the actual date yet, but it's just going to be due, you know, sometime after Thanksgiving during that final midterm time. It'd be definitely be best if y'all were mainly done, you know, before Thanksgiving, if at all possible. But the reason I give that time all the way until December is for those of you that might have gotten behind or something this semester, so you can catch up, get a lot of commits in, and you know, get things going again. So we'll announce the final due date next Tuesday. Well, next Monday, really. Yeah, next Monday or next Wednesday, I'll announce the real due date. Somebody's asking, do we meet on YouTube after 11:24 ever? Does the final open on Gradescope, and then that's it for class? Okay. So two questions here. First of all, do we meet on YouTube after 11:24 ever? And 11:24, just to be clear, is next, you know, is, yeah, next Tuesday. So what we're going to do is we'll have, you know, the final class next week, final official class. But what I think we're going to do is have just like a project showcase at some point, and I'll just announce that to y'all, and we'll have it one day, one random day on YouTube, kind of during finals and stuff like that. That won't be, so I think that's probably what we'll end up doing, is we'll have like a project showcase kind of thing. So probably one meeting after the final thing. Oh, and I missed, sorry, I forgot to answer the second part of that question, and I can't remember what it was. So, sorry, you might have to ask that again. Will the final exam be formatted similarly to the midterm? Yes, the final exam will be very similar to the midterm, and, you know, something that you can do at home, but it will be timed, and with the idea that you'll need to show some familiarity with tools, but also some conceptual familiarity with software engineering. Somebody's saying, should we create issues on GitHub for bugs? That would be awesome. I would highly recommend that. That would be awesome. And that's something that you could use, you know, when we do the final commits deliverable and you show your other activity, that's something that you could definitely share there and get credit for. So I would recommend that. I mean, not for every little bug, but for like, you know, major things that you want to work on. Yeah. So somebody's asking, will the second midterm be during the time assigned by VCU, or will it be like the first midterm where it was open over the entire day? So, yeah, I mean, we're all dealing with weird circumstances here, so I like to keep this a little more open like you suggest. So it'll probably just open on the day that VCU said our exam day was, and it'll probably be open for that day and maybe the next day, something like that. So you'll have some flexibility in when you take it. But yeah, it'll probably mainly be open the day of that exam, like the entire day. Remember, it'll be timed, so you only have a certain amount of time to work on it, but it'll be open for that entire day. So you can choose what time of day you want to work on it, for instance. Somebody's asking, is there a debugging course or lesson that you suggest? So there's no debugging game, unfortunately, that exists that I'm aware of. I think that would be super cool, kind of research project for somebody. I think debugging is a skill, and it's something that you can definitely learn, like as a skill. But yeah, I'm not aware of any kind of course or lesson. There's no like kind of automated lesson. It's really just, you know, debugging your own apps again and again. You'll start to see the same problems over and over, and then eventually you'll get good at identifying them. Somebody's asking, Do you want us to keep the cloned repository for future in-class activities? We will probably use this cloned repository again on Wednesday, so I would keep it around for at least one more, you know, till Wednesday. And after that, you can certainly delete it. But let's keep it around just for Wednesday at least. And I see one more question in the chat. Question is, what do you grade for when it comes to the final deliverable? Can you guys and gals guess what you think the most important thing will be for the final deliverable? Take a guess. Let me know in the chat. Can anybody guess? Exactly. Commits. Commits are the number one thing always that you can get credit for in this class, including for the final deliverable. Commits are the most important thing. High quality commits are the best. Commits at all are still good. And commits of even like extra project things are good. But commits are king. And somebody's asking, I meant other than commits. It's basically like the quality of the deliverable and the quality of the commits. I mean, the commits are really the thing, right? Like if I go over, I'm going to go over people's commits at the end of the semester, and it's going to be, I mean, there's just no hiding, right? Like when I see that you committed this code, I can actually like literally look at the code and I can judge how good the code is or not. And it's obvious like who's doing real commits and who's not. And real commits get credit, and real and like trivial commits are people that are putting in comments only, you know, that doesn't count. Code, and so somebody's asking about will we be grading on performance and code style and code readability? Yeah, so people that are gonna wanna, you know, get a, there's no A pluses at VCU, but people that are going to get high A's, they're going to have not only commits, but their code will look good and their app will be performant and I'll be able to understand and read their code. Absolutely. So those things matter. But usually people that are asking about grades are like, you know, just more concerned with not failing and stuff. So that's why I tend to talk about just committing the most. Course code style and performance and things like that, they absolutely matter. Somebody's asking, when do we have to have a certain amount of downloads by? If you remember, there's a certain amount of downloads that you can, if you get, you get automatic A's for your entire group. I have to go look in my notes to see what that number was. If you're going for that, you have until like the last day that grades are due. And but you'll need to, if you get those number of downloads, you just need to tell me so that I can update your grade. Great question. Glad to see that somebody might be thinking about that still. All right, any more questions from y'all? Somebody's asking, do we have to put the app on the store? No, you do not. The if you want to put the app on the store, I recommend it as a great exercise, but it's not something that is necessary. Even if you're not going for the large number of downloads, though, it is kind of illustrative. If you put it on the app store, you'll almost always get a review, and sometimes, you know, if you get a certain number of downloads, and sometimes you won't like what the review has to say, and it's really a good way to learn. What does it take to get good reviews on the App Store? Those users are quite demanding. All right. Well, thanks for hanging out with me today. I hope you all have a great rest of your day. And I will see you again on Wednesday. Take it easy, guys and gals. Look into my eyes, you will see.
everything I do.